the sound. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين. So inshallah, now we are going to embark upon such a topic which overlaps with Deen and Dunya, very, very much overlaps with Deen and Dunya. It is such a topic which, if you were to master this topic of time management, then everything in your entire life almost will fall in place. Everything. Your work, your studying, your marriage life, your children, your life with children, your life with the deen and the path to Allah, which is the most important thing, your life of conveying the message, your life of your own tazkiyah and purification, the time required for that would fall in place, your time for ascension would fall in place, your time for the fasting and gym and exercise would fall in place, your time for sleep and rest will be in place, your time for everything falling in place. And when the person's time is balanced and they've mastered this skill, this one success brings about many, many, many other successes. Many. They really don't stop the number of successes that come. But there, for the ultimate successes, there are conditions attached. Like you see, there are non-Muslims who are very good with time management, but they will benefit their 24 hours in this world, in dunya, but sadly there may not be any benefit, there won't be any benefit if they die in this state, in akhirah. But for Muslims, believers, when you manage time and you manage everything that falls under the time, then you begin to receive the benefits in this world, and you benefit, inshallah, in the hereafter. So this is going to be, inshallah, a very practical-based session. So there will be activities for you to do during the session as well. But the first thing, inshallah, I just want to quickly go through is, I'm not going to do any elaboration on Surah Al-Asr, but because Professor Saab, Professor Muhammad, inshallah, alhamdulillah, he went through some of the key points regarding it the other day. But here you see the surah, inshallah, very, very short, and it begins that in the name of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the most compassionate, the most merciful, by time, indeed, surely, mankind is in loss, except for those who have believed, done righteous deeds, advised each other on truth, and advised each other to patience. So many different major aspects mentioned there. And one of the things to understand there is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't mention all creation is in loss. Allah azza wa jalla mentioned only mankind is in loss. And when mankind is mentioned, it refers also to the jinnat as well. It's like when the word he is mentioned, it refers to she as well. He, she. So jinnat are included there. So what does that mean? That why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not mention the animals and the angels and the other kingdoms? Why are they not mentioned? Why are they not in loss regarding time? All they seem to do is eat, sleep, reproduce. But they're not in loss. If we just ate, slept and reproduced, we would be in loss. And one of the reasons then I mentioned that the animals, they have belief. So do you see those who have belief? The animals, the angels, the insects, all these other kingdoms, they have belief. So their first condition for successful time management is complete. Why would we then be unsuccessful if we didn't have belief? Because you could be the best at managing your time in this world, but as soon as death comes, all has gone to waste. Everything's gone to waste. Why? Because on the Day of Judgment, a person will be dipped inside Jannah and asked, did you go through any hardship in the world? And he will say, no. But he was a person who was poor, had nothing to eat, nothing to eat for days and days and days. They were orphaned. They were refugees. These types of people, Allah, they went through so much hardship in this world, and Allah will say to them on the day of judgment, dip in paradise, and then, did you experience any hardship in the world? They will say, no, Allah, we didn't experience any hardship. So they will be very successful. Then there will be people who in this world had everything, the money, the wealth, the people, the boss, the of businesses, and all sorts of things. They've obviously managed their time well if they were worldly wise successful. But they will be dipped in, so they had all the luxuries of dunya. They will then be dipped in Jahannam, and they will be asked. These are obviously unsuccessful people. Allah would not dip anyone in Jahannam for no reason. That is where they are going, but this is a lesson to me and you that this will happen. They will then be asked in front of all the people of the Medan Hashr. Everyone knew them. So these will be people that me and you will know. Everyone knew them. You took them as role models. This is my role model, footballer, pop star, actor. In front of everyone, they will be dipped and asked, did you enjoy any luxuries in dunya? Did you have anything? And they will say, no, I didn't experience any enjoyment. And yet they had everything. So in 1 second, they forgot everything that they had. So this is the effect of belief upon time management. So then there are others, good deeds, advising one another to the truth, which is conveying the message. And then after it, what does the patience refer to? Steadfastness. Like I mentioned the other day, like you can become purified, you can become impurified. So once the person has done the minimum level, they need to maintain this. And the minute they think, I am pure, is the minute that they've become impure. So steadfastness, patience requires steadfastness, and steadfastness requires patience. So I'm not going to go into that, but look at what Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah, which many, many people in the Muslim world follow in terms of fiqh and other sciences. He said that if the whole Quran wasn't revealed and only these three verses of Surah Al-Asr were revealed, this is one surah alone would be sufficient to take a person to Jannah. It would be enough as guidance. Why? Well, one of the reasons is that I mentioned right at the beginning, when the person manages their time, everything in their life becomes in its place. No pressure do they begin to feel, no stress, because everything is at its right time. Even the mind is organized. Even the heart becomes organized and it has its place. Even the spirit becomes organized. Everything can, within the time, they can be organized. And you just need to learn the first steps. And wherever step you're on, everyone in this room will be at different levels of time management. So it's difficult to give any speech because it's a practical subject. Time management is not a theoretical subject. It is not. It is a practical subject. If you listen only and you go away, you will not be able to manage time just by listening. You need to take practical steps and solutions to do these. And inshallah, it will be filled with practical solutions. You take which is for you, whichever level is for you. There will be different levels mentioned, inshallah. So one of the things which I'd like to share is very personal to me as well, is the teachings of Imam Ghazali, rahmatullahi alayhi, which is going to come up on the next slide. And because it was something which inspired me when Hazrat Sahib mentioned it a long, long time ago, that was what inspired me to then go and manage my time. And that's when my journey of managing time began. So, and hopefully it can inspire you too. So, but look at this very important hadith, very famous, which the Holy Prophet also mentioned, that you take advantage of five before the five. Take advantage of five before five. What are they? Your youth before you become old. You will definitely become old. So take advantage of the youth before you become old. It's a topic in itself. Your health before you become ill and sick. Your richness before you become poor. And your free time before you become busy. That preoccupy yourself before you become preoccupied. Busy yourself before you become busy. It's mentioned that the nafs, if you do not keep your nafs busy in good, it will keep you busy in bad. So this is very important. If you do not keep your... And remember the things I normally mention twice, I repeat, they're the things to sometimes write down. Those are things to memorize. That's why they're repeated. So if your nafs keeps you busy, if you do not keep your nafs busy in good, your nafs will keep you busy in bad. So free time is very, very harmful. Very harmful for people, having so much free time. Leisure time and free time are not the same thing. Realize this. I'm not saying don't have any leisure. You will see leisure within timetables. I'm saying time which is not allocated, that there is no objective behind this time, that what should I do now? That you will never hear the friends of Allah saying, I don't know what to do right now, what should I do? They have always planned ahead of time what to do then, what to do then, what to do then. Hardly ever would you ever hear someone say this, that I don't know what to do, I'm bored. They never get bored because they've always planned an objective in that slot, in that slot, in that slot. So occupy yourself before you become occupied. And you take advantage of your life before your death. This is the only life that you can use to attain the closeness of Allah Azza wa Jal. Imagine this, just one, it's the biggest thing. In Jannah, the highest level of Jannah, Jannat al-Firdaus, is the Jannat with creation stuff still there. There are trees, there are fruits, there are palaces, there are rivers and all sorts of wonderful things, and they are the highest quality. But there is a Jannat above there. Above doesn't mean that it's like this. Jannat doesn't have dimensions. There is a Jannat called Jannat al-Aliyah, mentioned in the Holy Quran. This Jannat, there is no creation there. There is nothing from creation. There is no hurs, no wives, no palaces, no nothing like this. There is only the blessed vision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there. And that is where the awliya Allah and the friends of Allah will yearn to be. They don't even want Jannah. They don't want Jannah. They don't work for Jannah. They only strive for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then finally to see Him, the beloved that they've been waiting for so long. In this dunya, no matter what you see, you can never see Allah. But in Jannah, Jannat al-Aliya, there they see Allah. Now why am I saying this regarding time? Because who are those that will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then? They are those who used this time in this world beneficially. And those who wasted this time, those who didn't reach this a level to then be able to be permitted to see Allah in Jannah. Imagine when you die, you cannot increase your status. In this sense, you become like an angel. You don't become an angel, but angels cannot increase their status. They can't do anything to become more closer to Allah. They, whatever they're given, they're given. They can't do any good deeds to increase. They can't purify themselves because they're already purified. They don't have any temptation to sin because they are sinless. So in this sense, after death, you also become like that, that you don't have free will anymore. Your wonderful ability to choose between good and bad has gone. So you have no free will. You cannot increase your closeness and status. Only in this special time you have now can you ever do this. So how important is this time? That this time you spend is the time in which you can become, have access to become one of those who will see Allah in Jannah. And otherwise you waste this time, then you can never get that. Does anybody know the one thing which can be worse than Jahannam and the one thing which can be better than Jannah? Imagine the great saint Sayyidina Abdulaziz Barahimullah was asked this question. The scholar Hamad Ahmad Mubarak asked so many people, so many scholars, so many of the mashayikh. Nobody could give him an answer. That is there one thing which can be better than Jannah and one thing which can be worse than Jahannam? The one, I'm not going to mention the other, the one thing better than Jannah, because it's too difficult to understand. But the one thing which is worse than Jahannam is that a person can never, ever, ever meet their Lord and never can see Allah's blessed face. That they will have such a regret, such a punishment in the Akhirah, that I've lost the very purpose of my existence, my life, that the time has now passed, it's expired, and Allah will say to them people that never call upon me this day. Never call upon me this day. And they will be filled with the regret that is unimaginable, the feeling and the punishment that they will that will bring upon them. So a person, when they go through that, they would rather... Have you never seen people commit suicide and heard them? They commit suicide. They happens all the time in the UK. Why do they commit suicide? They think that this suicide will release me of the pain I feel. So they kill themselves. So here in Jahannam, people will say that bring death. So they are feeling so much despair not seeing Allah. Imagine, why are they asking for death? One of the reasons that they're asking for more pain is to destroy this feeling of that I regret not reaching Allah and I can never meet Him and see Him now. So realize your real purpose is in there, in meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and pleasing Him and reaching His closeness. And this time is the only time you have to reach it. Because a time will come when you will realize, and we will realize. Another ayat of the Holy Quran regarding the value of time is, on the Day of Judgment, people will say that, O Allah, send me back. Send me back so that I may do good deeds and so that I may believe. So what does this mean? Think about it. Day of Judgment hasn't happened yet. It's not happened. So where are they asking Allah Azawajal to send them back to? They are asking, and I don't say they, I say you, because you will be amongst them, that you will be on the Day of Judgment as well. Hopefully we won't be in this category. But so these people will say, Oh Allah, send me back to where Mohsin is sitting now, to where Professor Saab is sitting now, to where Abdul Rahman is sitting now, to where Junaid and Zishan and myself are sitting now. They will want to come where me and you are sitting right now. So how valuable is this time that you will realize on the Day of Judgment, Oh Allah, I don't want to be here on the Day of Judgment. I can see the Prophet ﷺ now. You can see him. Everyone says, I want to see the Holy Prophet ﷺ. Well, on the Day of Judgment, you can see him. But you're saying, Allah, send me back here where I can't see him. How strange a matter. You can see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can see the angel, Jannah, Jahannam. People want to see paradise. On the Day of Judgment, you can see them, but you're saying, Oh Allah, send me back to dunya, where the very place where I could have changed my destiny. So ponder upon those words, because they are not something which is understood by listening. They are understood by deep thinking. So ponder upon them after, inshallah, they will benefit. So now look at the words of Imam Ghazali, rahmatullahi alayhi, and what his guidance is regarding time. Then inshallah, we'll do one activity and then show some practical steps. So Imam Ghazali, rahmatullahi alayhi, says, and imagine he's saying this to you directly, you should not neglect time or use it haphazardly, which means wastefully. Like just willy-nilly, it's nothing special, it's just time. On the contrary, you should bring yourself to account, structure your litanies and other practices during each day and night, and assign each period during the day and night a fixed and specific function. So what this litanies just means, your tasks. So every moment, day and night, should have tasks there that you are doing. Do not misunderstand and think that tasks means I'm always busy. Task could is also means spending time with the family. That's a task, that's a litany as well. Spending, shutting off from the world and just enjoying and relaxing. This is a task as well. So when you have time management, you even know when to rest. When you assign your time and structure it, even going to the bathroom has its time. Even sleeping has its time. Those people who sleep whenever they feel like that, I don't feel like sleeping, I'm not going to sleep. So, but they haven't structured time or a plan. They're following maybe their feelings, unless they're different, that they don't need much sleep. Most mankind needs 8 hours sleep. Majority needs 8 hours sleep, 7-8 hours sleep. Very few people need less than that. So everything should have a structure. You should already know before itikaf, before you leave, what are you doing on the itikaf. Eid might be on Thursday. You should know what you're doing on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and the week ahead. How many have planned the week after itikaf? But if you decide I'm only going to plan it then, well then, what will you do if you're going to plan today for tomorrow? Tomorrow's activities may be something that there is a deadline approaching, and that deadline you may have missed. Why do so many people miss applications for certain things? They've not planned well in advance. It should be planned much more in advance, inshallah. So every time, the main thing is, don't use it like it's nothing, like it's just money that you can give here and there. It's much, much more precious than money. They say time, your time is money. You've heard this saying, business people say, time is money. Really, this is more of a misconception. It has its meaning, but it is more of a lie. Why? Because money has its value. Money, you can put value on it, that this 60,000 can buy this house and so on. So money has its value. But your time is valueless. It is precious. It is completely priceless. So how can you put value on something which is priceless? Your time, 1 second of Tawbah, is all you would need to wipe out Jahannam. One tear of fear of Allah can wipe a quarter of hellfire for you. And one tear of love of Allah can wipe out half of the hellfire for you. So imagine 2 tears out of the love of Allah. It took a second maybe to do, but it wiped out Jahannam for the person. So look at the value of time. Can money do this? No, it can never do that. So this is how to bring about the spiritual blessings in each period. But if you leave yourself adrift, aimlessly wandering as cattle do, the animals, not knowing how to occupy yourself, at every moment your time will be lost. So the more you don't know how to manage time, the more time will be lost, is what he's saying. The more the spiritual blessings of that time will be lost, the more you don't use it effectively. There is blessing in the tahajjud time. There is blessing in ishraq time after the sunrise. There is blessing in the morning. And there is blessing in every time, even after asr, before, after azan, till the prayer. Maghrib and Fajr, Sunnat Askars, that every time has its special allocation of things to do. But you will lose the spiritual blessing if you haven't assigned, I will do this then, this then, this then, and at least like this. So not knowing how to occupy yourself, that you're becoming like the animals. The animals, they're not sinful at all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them in this way. Why do they not need to manage time? Because the answer is, they are fulfilling their purpose of life. And their purpose of life amongst them is that they are constantly worshipping Allah, constant in the remembrance and the zikr of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, there is nothing in the heavens and the earth that does not glorify your Lord. And the Holy Prophet also mentioned, everything recognizes him. So they are fulfilling their purpose of life, so they can do eat, sleep, and marry. No, they don't even marry, they reproduce. So they can do them and they are fine because they're fulfilling their purpose. But for us to fulfill the purpose, we have free will. And because of this free will, you need to begin to manage the time wisely. And then you will fulfill your purpose. So then Imam Ghazali says, Rahmatullah, it is nothing other than your life, and your life is the capital, the very thing which you can use, that you make use of to reach perpetual felicity, the proximity of Allah the Exalted. So perpetual felicity just means extreme closeness to Allah and presence and intimacy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, but the first part is this, that your time is your life. So if you think, oh, time management, I don't need to do it, then it's like you're saying, I don't need, my life is waste. My life is not important. Those who think time is not important, they're saying my life is not important. So what kind of value have you given to yourself? If you cannot value yourself, you cannot value your time. Then value yourself. You are ummati of the Holy Prophet ﷺ. Every prophet and messenger before the Holy Prophet ﷺ wanted to be an ummati. So value the time in which you live in, because they value it. And they imagine you have such a thing which prophets ﷺ do not have. So the time in which you are born is a blessed time. So each of your breaths is a priceless jewel, since each of them is irreplaceable and once gone can never be retrieved. So every breath, every single breath, every heartbeat is precious. Do not be like the deceived fools who are joyous because each day their wealth increases whilst their life shortens. So those people who are this fine to become happy, alhamdulillah, you have a good work, good business and so on. This is good, but do not be heedless of your very thing which is running out, which is more precious. Your breaths, your glances, you have risk in these as well. Everyone has an allocated share of wealth, but you also have an allocated share of footsteps, an allocated share of glances, an allocated share of speech. Everyone has this. Do you not see those people who lose their voice? They cannot speak anymore. Sometimes this happens, people lose their voice, but their risk for speech has stopped. Do you not see those who become blind? Their risk for sight has stopped before their death. Everything doesn't stop with death, things stop before. Do you not see those who lose their feet and their legs in their limbs? Their risk of walking has stopped. So risk is in these ways as well. So what good is an increase in wealth when life grows ever shorter? Therefore be joyous only in increase of knowledge and good works, good deeds, for they are your companions who will accompany you in the grave when your family, wealth, children and friends stay behind. How many have lost their parents and the family relatives? How often we think of them? How often we pray of them? So when you go in the grave, people will leave you then as well. Unless you've left good pious children behind, they will remember you and send reward, and they'll remember you every day. Like your parents, when they have children, many of you have children, you change the nappies and you feed the babies and you work for them and you play with them. They need constant supervision, 24 hours a day. How many of us spend this time for our parents? When the principle was that you take care of the children when they're babies, and when they grow older, you become elderly, then the children take care of the elderly. But how many of us take care of our time with our elderly parents? But rather people are in this mentality, oh, it's a burden to look after my parents, it's a burden. It's no burden. In one khidmat of your parents is more good deeds and pleasure of Allah than in all ittikaf, in 40 days khulwat, in doing for the whole year. Sometimes there is more goodness in serving one's parents. So this a person needs to realize that those people who are blessed to still have parents and they serve them, they clean them, they feed them, what a great honor they have. And you cannot even begin to imagine the greatness of reward and pleasure Allah they get. But those sad people who think it's a burden, they are really the burden upon their parents, those children who think like this. So do not become like them. And never think this is a waste of your time. This is a blessing for you, and maybe it will be the means for you to be saved from Jahannam. So inshallah, this is the teachings regarding Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi. Now what I want you to do is an activity, and inshallah then I'll show you some of the correct objectives, the different things that you can have. What I want you to do is think about your future. Now I've mentioned about managing time. Time is now, but time is also in the future. Those people who don't plan for their future, and this is the future of the world and the future of the hereafter. The simple principle is keep death in mind. Always keep death in mind. If you forget death, then planning for tomorrow is a bad thing if you forget death. But if you remember death, you can plan for your pension and your retirement as long as you've remembered death. So always keep death in mind. So now, inshallah, what I want you to do is do an activity where you will write down three things that you want to achieve in 10 years' time. I'm going to give you, inshallah, 3 minutes, maybe a little bit longer. Three things that you want to achieve in 10 years' time. So have an activity you can discuss with people next to you. Maybe this is the first time you've ever thought about this. 10 years' time, how old will you be? Where will you be in the world? You can begin now, inshallah, I'll just help you. Where will you be in the world? Who will you be with? What kind of things you want to attain? So 10 years' time from now. Make them realistic. Okay. Inshallah, I'm going to come round and help and listen to a few as well. But you stay in your seats, inshallah, I'll just come round and listen to a few. Inshallah, you can carry on and for a few more minutes. And just to, some of you have said many good things. For example, I want closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you need to make your objective, your practical objective, something you can say, I have it, I don't have it. So it needs to be something like that. Closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something which you cannot say, it's unlimited. It's unlimited, and then you cannot say, I have closeness, I don't have closeness. But you can say, I've completed the second stage, I've completed the third stage, and so on. So you can say something like this. So it needs to be something that you can ask yourself, do I have it, do I not? So inshallah, one more minute, and then the next. And then if anybody wants to share some of them, inshallah, you may share. They don't have to be deen related only. They can be dunya related as well. What have you two chosen? What he said? Ah, marriage, mashallah. Today? You want to finish the call? Mashallah, very good. Okay then, 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1, inshallah. So there, if anyone wants to mention the few, they can mention, Brother Mizan, inshallah. So would anybody like to share some of their tenure objective, inshallah? If it's too personal, it's fine, you don't have to, but others will benefit. Yes, uncle. Okay, mashallah, the first and the third ones are very practical, where you can say you have them, you don't have them. But the second one, what was the second one again?
Be more learned about the deen, Quran, understand the Quran and the Hadith and where to read that in itself.
Yeah, so on this one you need to put a limit to it. So how, it needs to be more specific. So how learned do you want to be? How scholarly, or what? How much of Quran do you want to have memorized or understand? So it needs a limit where you can ask yourself, have I achieved this, have I not? Otherwise you may have referred to one page, or is it 100 pages? So make that more practical, make it more realistic. Okay, yes brother. Sorry? Okay, mashallah. So helping orphans and creation. So again, this one is general. So make it more specific, that do you want to spend an amount of time helping them on a weekly basis? Or do you have a number of orphans that you want to help? So do you see you need to put a number to it, a time, something you can hold yourself accountable? Do you see? So if you just say, I want to help the orphans, this is a wish, but there's no practical level where you can say, I've achieved that level now. There's no practical level. So any others, inshallah, just a few more. So you can see the difference between making a clear, specific, or smart, they call it, smart objective, compared to a one where it doesn't have these elements. Anybody else? Yes, Brother Majid. Yeah. Yes. Excellent, mashallah. I like all of them objectives. Not sure about the second wife one though, but all of them were very good. Why? Because they are all things that you can say, I have it or I don't have it. Now, inshallah, we're going to use some of them ones to do the next task. But you will all use your own individual. So let's use the example of, I want to get married in the next 10 years. Depends on the person's age. Now, what your next task should be is that in 5 years' time, what do I need to attain? What objectives do I need to have fulfilled and tasks in order to fulfill the 10-year task? Okay, so what do you want to have attained in the 5 years that will help you towards the 10 years? Now, so this is the task. If you find that those 10-year ones, you want to attain them in 5 years, that means that it should be in your 5-year objective, not your 10-year. But if you find that, yes, I don't want to get married in 5 years' time, it's fine. If you don't want to get married in 5 years' time, then what can you do? What do you need to do in order to become married in 10 years' time? So this is one example. Another example is you mentioned studying, that in 10 years I want to have finished all my studies. So then you need to decide, okay, in 5 years' time, what do I need to have done? Let's say a person wants to do a PhD. So that means, and they're only 16. Your PhD begins at age of 24-ish. So in 10 years' time, they need to have this A-level, this degree, this level of degree. Then they can begin their PhD, for example. So you need to break that down. What do you want to achieve in 5 years that will help towards the 10-year gap? It might just be half. I want to achieve half of that. Depends. Everyone's will be different. So inshallah, you need to do now, for the few more minutes, for your 5-year objective. You can do some for deen, some for dunya. This is better if you do some deen, some dunya. Inshallah. So 3 minutes, 4 minutes for this, you can discuss again. But then I want you to write them down. It's very important you write it down. Okay, some of you may not be writing, you need to write it down. Because very rare do people ever do this task, what they really want from life in, and so on. So inshallah, do this, and this time I'll go on this side. So inshallah. Thank you. Okay, so Bismillah. So inshallah, some people have now realized that their five-year target is really, or their 10-year target was really within 5 years, that you want to achieve this in 5 years. Now already we've not even finished, and you've seen that you were not aware of when you wanted to attain certain things. And look at Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi's guidance here. This is how, so the second paragraph, this is how to bring about the spiritual blessings in each period. And what is he referring to? It's the above part. You should bring yourself to account, structure your litanies and other practices during each day and night, and assign each period during the day and night a fixed specific function. Now, I've been through people before how to do this on a daily basis. So this is why this time I'm showing you how to do that same guidance, but for the future, for the distant future. Now, some of you will see that my 5 year is my 10 year, my 10 year is my 5 year. And it will put your life into perspective. You will, it's as though you're seeing your future life and it's in a picture for you. You know where you want to go for each thing. So it's organizing your future is what you're really doing. Now, inshallah, anyone want to mention their 5 year plan? Brother Abdurrahman, did you have? So, mashallah, very good intention. You want to complete the first 3 stages by then. Did that relate to your 10-year plan? Yes, so that's fine. This is also correct. As you're doing your 5-year plan, your 10-year plan will change because you will realize that that 10-year plan should be something different. So what was your 10-year plan now? To be? Very good, mashallah. That is a very, it's something that you can measure. How I want to be steadfast on the 3 stages for 5 consecutive years. Imagine Sayyidina Abdul Qadir Jilani rahimahullah has mentioned that different things, but for 40 years in a row, there was, and it was from the age of Baligh, he had not even once looked at an Amahram. Once looked at an Amahram for 40 years in a row is mentioned in books. No minor sins, never mind major sins, but for 40 consecutive years, never even once had he looked at an Amahram. And how often do we? So you can make objectives for your eyes and ears and so on. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah is mentioned 27 or something like this years he worshipped the night. In the night he was worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 27 years in a row. So steadfastness for a period of time is a good objective as well. Anybody else? It can be dunya ones as well. Yes, brother. Okay, mashallah. So you see, marriage has been mentioned quite a few, maybe 3-4 people I've heard already. Some people mention marriage in their 10-year plan, but marriage maybe should be in your 5-year plan. And so in your 10-year plan, you're not going to get married again, unless the one person wants 2 wives. So in your 10-year plan might be that you want to have 1 or 2 children. And maybe this is fine. You can plan for this as well, inshallah. So do you see, and before you get married, you might want to do certain other things. So now, the next task now is where the real benefit lies. The real benefit doesn't lie in the 5 and 10 year plan. The real benefit lies in below 2 years. Because in 2 years, like you heard Hazrat Sahib mention today, well, you didn't hear, but we heard, the Mashayikh said that if a person travels the journey to Allah, after they've done the 3 stages, in 2 years, they can travel the ascension journey and travel to closeness of Allah Azza wa Jal. Then it just on and on and on, and more closeness to Allah never ends. So in 2 years, your life can dramatically change. A person goes from being non-Muslim to Muslim and being scholarly type of Muslim in 2 years, he can do. A person can do hifz within 2 years. A person can do learn Arabic within 2 years. A person can transform their life from shaitanic life, from distant, very, very far away, to being one of the most steadfast on deen in 2 years. Sayyidina Abdul Qadir Jilani rahimahullah again came to one of his mashayikh, and in 2 years, the Zawiya, everything was already running. The students, the teacher, everything was there. He came when it was all set up. And in 2 years, he surpassed everyone. So 2 years, do you see how much you can do in 2 years? So now your objective, your task to do now, is write down three things that will take you towards your 5 year gap, your 5 year objectives and your 10. These need to be practical that you can measure them. The 2 year one shouldn't be the same as the 5. The 5 shouldn't be the same as the 10. They should each be advanced. So now your two, what do you want to have achieved in 2 years? Do you want to get married in 2 years? Or do you want to be, do you want to have viewed, maybe met 5 different people? You know, do you want to have made your marriage, people call it marriage CV, and do you want to have sent that around? Or do you want to have prepared, you know, it's not necessary that you have a perfect job and perfect house before you get married. This is a misconception, but maybe this is an objective you've made. So is that what you want to do? Remember mentioning regarding, because 4 people have mentioned marriage. To be married, you do not have to have the perfect job and the perfect career, the perfect everything. Because then they're looking for perfection, and there's no such being as perfection other than prophets and messengers. And no one today is going to get married to prophets, alayhi wasalam, except the lucky person to marry Hazrat Isa alayhi wasalam when he returns. But other than that, you will not be looking for perfection. So now write your 2 year target down, inshallah, and then immediately after, what you will also be doing is your 1 year target. Your 1 year target, and then there we will stop. So do a 2 year target, do a 1 year target, objectives you want to fulfill, but the 1 year needs to lead to the 2 years. The 2 years needs to lead to the 5 needs to lead to the 10. This is how it should be done. So inshallah, make a start on this. This is also time management. So this comes under time management. Yes. It's 4 to 5 sheets. There's 4 sheets mainly, but there's 5 really. Mine has 10 levels. Yes. Sorry? Yeah, I'm coming. Yeah, it's perfectly fine. If you need any help, inshallah, I'll come. Remember, I said this is practical based, inshallah. So Alhamdulillah, mashallah. What, you can carry on for a few more minutes as you do that, and I'll mention what some people are experiencing. Some of you are experiencing, like, you want to do something like maybe serve the parents, or you want something for your children. You already have children. This is also good, but you need to make it more tangible, that what do I need to do to serve my parents? Serving parents is vague, but what do I need to do? Is it take them out once a week? Is it release them from work? Maybe your parents are still working and they're very elderly. Maybe it will be that in 5 years' time, I want that my parents don't have to work anymore. So if that's what you want, then your two-year plan needs to be something along that line. So for example, I want in 2 years my mother and father, they don't work, only maybe part-time they work, just as a hobby. So then you're then going to decide, what do I do to bring this about? So do you see, serving parents, making my children hafiz and things like this, this is a little bit vague. You need to make it more practical based. And this is why I say time management is really one-to-one things. You can learn some things from theory, listening like this, but the practical, when you sit with someone, they will help you that is not, that's too vague. You need to make it more tangible, that you can decide, can I do it, can I not? So now, inshallah, what you have realized from there, you've realized many realizations that many of you didn't know what you want in 10 years or 5 years or 2 years. You'd never thought about it. So if you cannot know what you want for the future, how will you do something today to affect that? Because let me tell you this, if you have a yearly target, the year is made up of months. The month is made up of days, weeks. The week is made up of days, and the days are made up of hours. If you want to achieve your yearly target, then you need to have a target in the hour, a target in the week, a target in the month, a target in the year. So this is how it works. So you work backwards, decide what you want to achieve by the end of this year that will take you to your 2 year, 5 year, and 10 year goals. Then you bring the tasks. They have to be tasks orientated. Tasks means it's something I do, whether it be the body, the mind, the heart, it's something I do. It has to be something you do. And it needs to be maybe an hourly thing, maybe a daily task, maybe a weekly, maybe a yearly. So a monthly and then yearly. So this is how this works. So I'm going to, inshallah, try and give you some examples. And the example works very well with the from the deen side, the sheets. So let's say in 1 year, I want to complete the 7 organs of the body, the 7 sheets. You've got 7 organs, that's 7 months, but you're giving yourself, Junaid, you're giving yourself 1 year. 1 year to do it. So then you might decide that, okay, in 6 months, I need to have done 3 or 4 sheets. That means in 2 months, I need to do 1 sheet. So 1 sheet, you're now giving yourself, I have a target, I need to fix this tongue in 2 months if I want to reach my yearly target. So you look at it this perspective. Now, that itself will give you the motivation to do the tongue sheet, then the eyes, then the ears. And if you don't do something like this, then you will just think, oh, it's okay, I'll do it one day, it'll be done. And then before you know it, and there are people here, before you know it, 10 years will pass and you've not completed the course. 20 years will pass and you've not completed the course. So why is that? It's because you didn't plan for the future, and before you knew it, time passed. So this, do this, what is being said here, that now forget about the past. Leave the past, it's the past. You cannot change the past, so we cannot manage the past. We can manage and plan the future. So now make a task, and for the hour, for the day, that you will then do in the week, that a task which will then fulfill the month task, and a task which will fulfill the month to the yearly task. You need to work like this. Now this will take more time, but you have to spend this time in your own time. So this is why in itikaf, in your own time, don't just sleep. You're asleep in the sleep times, but in the other times, sit with each other. You don't need to only sit with the speakers and so on. Sit with each other and help each other to plan your month, your week, your day, that what do you want to attain? And ask yourself, if I ask you, anyone, and I will, when I speak to you, inshallah, I'm going to ask people, that what is your daily task which will help you towards your 10-year task. Inshallah, I'm going to ask people so that I want you to be able to give me an answer. So I may not ask for the 10-year because this is a bit harder, but at least for the 2-year. That what is your daily task to help you towards your 2-year goal? This is the question. And you all should be able to answer this. And it will take an hour for you to sit there and plan this. An hour, inshallah. So this is a very practical thing for you to do. And if you want to manage your plan, your time, your future, your weeks, months and ahead, this is one activity which can be done. Do it again and again, every so often. Reassess it. And look at what Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi's first, one of the messages is. So it's on the very first beginnings. That shows how important it is that you should not neglect time or use it haphazardly. This is the person. Do you see what you've just done there, the task you've done? Now you're not using it willy-nilly, haphazardly. That it's not just anything that you throw away. It's something special that you are taking care of because you're running out. On the contrary, you should bring yourself to account. That's the part I was asking, looking for. You should take yourself to account. And this is exactly what you all have just done. But I've said it will take another hour of your own time to complete the task. You can ask yourself, in 10 years, these are the things I want. In 5 years, in 2 years, in 6 months, in 1 month, in 1 week, and in 1 day. These are the things I want to hold myself to account for. And if you can hold yourself to account for them, then inshallah you will reach them. And how I'd like to end is, inshallah, with some examples. So give me some examples and let's make a 5-year, 1-year, week and month and so on timetable, task for it. So who would like to give an example that they need, that they want help with? So anyone mention what your 2-year objective is? Everyone shy now? Yes, brother. Okay, so 2 years just for the mind level. Okay, mashallah, that's fine. So in 2 years' time, you want to have been through the first and second stage. Yeah? So you added up all the levels, 10 plus 7, so 17, and then you look how many months there are in 2 years, 24. Okay, so it's approximately 2 levels per month. So now you can question yourself that from this July that has just begun, or this ittikaf, do it from ittikaf to ittikaf. Do it like this. Ittikaf to ittikaf. So 2 ittikafs later, I should have completed the mind stage. But next ittikaf, I should have done the first stage. And every 2 months, I should have done one organ. And if I don't do that, write this down, put it on your wall. Many people do this. Put it on your wall. And then show the timeline there. This is another technique for time management. A timeline going from July 2016, July 17, and July 18. And each, show your future in front of you. That at this, in August or in September, I've done the tongue sheet. In November, I've done the ear sheet. As though you're looking into your future. When you see that every day, then you will know that that's where I need to be. That's where I need to be. You're going to follow your timeline. Those of you who do this when you go home, inshallah, you will benefit from this session. And those who don't do it, then you only heard something regarding time, but you didn't take something away with you. So take that, make a timeline on your wall. Many successful people in the world, dunya-wise, they do this type of thing. They have their objectives and their a plan in the future on their walls. They see it every day. Some people put it above them, so when they wake up, they see like this. So this is fine. And then, inshallah, you will reach these things because your mind is programmed. You're programming your mind that I need to attain this. I need to do it. I need to do it. And the mind will help you even to do it. And because of your intention, what did the first hadith in, is it Bukhari, Sharif? That actions are based on intentions. Now look at your intention. For the full 2 years, you have an intention of abstaining from sins and purifying the mind. Every single day, the intentions are being refreshed. Do you then not think that your actions will follow the intention? Do you not think you will be rewarded based on your intention? If the person dies like that, planning their future, that I will purify myself like this. then he will be raised as though he was purified, even if he didn't reach the end. So this is a wonderful example. The course is made such that you can ask yourself, it's tangible, which means you can ask yourself, have I done it, have I not? So let's use another one example, a worldly example, and then inshallah we'll take questions. So any other example? Yes, brother. Yes, mashallah. So that's your mashallah, jazakallah, brother. He's mentioning the example of people who've made billionaires. Imagine we all want to be billionaires, but not billionaires of dunya, of the world, billionaires of akhirah. So we should all want to be billionaires. So, but these people have made their money their objective, which is fine. You can also do the same as long as money itself is not a bad thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to wealth as rahman, mercy, 4 times or so in the Holy Quran. It's not the money that is bad, it's how it's used. So it's the disease of the heart that's bad. So money itself is fine. So it's all about how it's used. The person, the brother is saying, he checked every hour, am I on the task to fulfill, to reach my objective? Am I on task? Am I on task? Am I on task? And so this is jazakallah for sharing. And we should be doing the same, applying it to our world and our akhirah as well. So one more example, inshallah. If you mention your example, you can have this help now. It might change a person's life. Yes, brother. Okay, mashallah. So when do you want to do Hajj? The 5-year target, okay. 3-year target is? Is 2? Okay, so now there's different ways for Hajj. You want to do in 5 years. Hajj is such a thing which other people have mentioned as well. Hajj, firstly, you should know, is such a thing which as soon as 4 things are upon you, Hajj becomes farz this year, not 5 years late or 10 years late. And you cannot be that person who says, I'll do it 5 years, but the 4 farz upon you now. So what are they? The wealth, you have the wealth to go. Then you have the time to go, that there's nothing stopping you time-wise. For example, you can get time off work. Your parents are not so ill that you cannot leave them. They're fine and you can go. Or you have a very young child and you have no one to take care of them. So for these examples of, you have the time. Third one, you have health, that you don't have sickness. You don't have to keep going to the hospital. You don't have something which is making you faint or severe illness, not mild illness. Severe illness. So if you have health, that you have the wealth and you have the time. And the fourth one is for the females, that they have a mahram. So if you have these 4, then Hajj is farz upon you now, today, this year, not next year. So you should be, if you have them 4, it should be in 3 months' time, not 5 years. So what you can do for Hajj is that if, let's say, you've not done Hajj and you want to make it a 2-year plan, then make sure these 4 farz are in place. They're the 4 things that you need to make sure. It doesn't apply to men, the mahram, but for the sister, they should encourage one of their brothers or husband or father that, I'd like to do Hajj, you know, do you think you'll be able to go? Let's try and go. She needs to encourage their mahram to try and go. But the other 3, you can make them your 2-year plan. So the wealth, how much wealth do you need? About 4,500. So you've got 2 years to plan from now. How 4,500 divided by 24, just say it's 48,000 divided by 24, becomes £200 a month. So £200 or however much a month, this is how much you need. So save £200 a month, you've got enough for Hajj, don't touch that. £200 for the next 2 years, and you've got enough for Hajj. Now, for the health, not that you cannot plan, but what you can plan is that I will exercise and I will eat healthy. So you can start, make a diet plan, make a health plan, so that you don't have diabetes because of, diabetes type 2 most people get because of diet. So you can make the plan to avoid diabetes type 2. Majority of the people in UK get it because of a bad diet. Especially in Asian population, it's more. So you can make this plan that I will exercise and I will eat healthy so that I don't have, Allah knows best. And the other one, health, wealth, and then time. Plan. Imagine you're planning for 2 years. If you have a job, you have to ask permission off work, and you go to job and say, in 2 years, I want to go on Hajj, I need these days off. Do you think they will say no? You're giving them 2 years notice? Of course not. They might not, if their their Excel sheet or whatever they use for time off might not even be filled for available for 2 years. But you tell them, as soon as it's available, let me know and I will book those days off. So look at the calendar for 2 years from now, Hajj. Then go to work and tell them, I will take this time off. If you're self-employed, you don't need to ask anyone's permission. Just make sure you work before and after, and then you can go in Hajj. So do you see those practical things you can do to plan for Hajj? But be aware, for Hajj, as soon as the four upon a person, they should go. And the Holy Prophet ﷺ said, meaning that I do not care if he dies a Christian or a Jew. So very famous hadith it is. So those people who say, I am waiting for my teacher to go, the sheikh to go, and they really are not following the mashayikh, is what they need to understand. If they say, I'm waiting for my teacher to go, the teacher's instruction is more important than their company. And their instruction is the instruction of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, and that is, go as soon as it's farz upon you, not wait for me. So, and there are many examples in the seerah where this type of thing happened. The companions, imagine, so severe. Some companions, the Holy Prophet ﷺ told them to go on jihad or tabligh, wherever it was. They didn't go immediately. They came back after Fajr. So this was Isha time, they were told, and they stayed so that they can see him one last time. Imagine, for love, to see him one last time. This is time management as well. When you're told something, you do it immediately. You don't wait. So they waited and they came at Fajr time to see him, and he saw them there after the prayer and said, oh, such and such, and they came. And then said to them, did I not, to this meaning, these are not the exact words, did I not tell you to go? Why are you still here? And they said that, Ya Rasulullah, we just wanted to see you one last time. And then he told them, to this meaning, that because of this which you have done, you will be delayed 500 years from entering paradise. 500 years from entering paradise because you delayed my command, my direct command. So just look at this. So the command of the mashayikh and the Prophet ﷺ is superior to being in the company. And one needs to understand. And it applies to Hajj as well. So, inshallah, now we'll just briefly take some questions and then we can all rest. And this is rest time. Then you rest. So any questions, inshallah? Yes. No. So those, and that's fine to do this. This is even another task which is beneficial. Inshallah, next time if I have a chance, I'll probably do this. It's referred to as the wheel of life, but you separate your life into about 8 different chunks, and then you give it a score. So you can do this in your own time. I'm just going to explain it. You give each one a score that on 0 to 10, where am I? So let's say, for example, finance, relationships. People, how many people assess their relationships? My relationship with my mother, with my father, with my brothers and sisters, the wife, the children. So what score is it on? Then you give it as 10 is excellent, perfect, doesn't need to even be there. 0 is non-existent. So then you other things like your time management. Another one is your work-life balance. Another one is your career prospects. Another one of the deeni related ones is your path to Allah. So important, most important. Another one might be your studying. So you give each one a score, and it's on the inner circle. So it's in the inside. Then above them, if anything is, for example, below 4, is 1 to 4, then you need to look at, what do I need to do to take that one thing to the next level? So how do I get it from a 4 to a 5 or a 3 to a 4? Only you can ask yourself, but you can discuss it with somebody. So then they will tell you that you will discuss to get your relationship with your, let's say, old friends. Some of you have old friends, you never see them. and you say this is on a three, I hardly see them. What can you do to make your relationship with your friends a four? So one simple thing you can do on a weekly basis is invite them to a meal out. Go and do a sport with them. Invite them to this gathering. You've not spoke to them in a long time. So that will take your relationship with your old friends from a three to a four. If it's a relationship with the wife, let's say it's on a four or five, but you want it to go to eight or nine. Well, that's a big jump. You need to go in small jumps. So you need to write down, how do I take the relationship from four or five to about a six? Six is a better step. So if it's on a four or five, then say maybe it's send them a surprise gift. A surprise gift, it doesn't be anniversary or birthday or these things. Surprises are better, they become very happy. So, and it doesn't have to be expensive gift. Everyone says it's the thought that counts. It could be that I will tell them how much I love them. And how often do people say, I love you, I love you? Sometimes rarely do they say it, but just today you might want to say that you're very important to me, I love you very much, and I miss you, and this type of thing. So it might just be saying something which they didn't expect. Words are charity as well. So then there are parents, your relationship with parents. It might be that you, as I just mentioned yesterday, taking them out. Or it could be that you give them a massage, that you say, Father, Mother, I want to give you a massage, not for your benefit, for my benefit, for me to benefit. How happy do you think they become? So you're taking the level of each one from a lower score to a higher score. Then when it's on a higher score, you could take it to the next and the next. And you only ever look at the aspects of your life. This is a way of making your daily and weekly aspects of your life higher. Your daily. This is not for yearly plan, what we were doing. What I'm mentioning to you, Brother Abdurrahman, is for a weekly or a short-term change. So it's more like a month thing. And so you do this every month. So does everyone follow? So that's how you separate them into eight aspects, give them all a score, then on the next pie or the next circle, you write down what practical task you can do to take it from a four to a five to a six, and so on. So this is, they call the wheel of life, and it is a very effective way of assessing your life. You see your life in a pie chart. So that's fine to do that. That is a separate task to what we were doing. We were looking at long-term targets and how they should be reduced to 5 years, to 2 years, to monthly, weekly, and then daily. And then what you're talking about is how you can make the monthly target achieved. It's a way of achieving. So let other people have a chance first, inshallah. So is there anybody else? Just two more questions and we finish for break. Yes, Brother Masan. Yes. Yeah, this is why you should, that's why I made it all individual. Each one of you did your own. I didn't tell you what to write. You wrote your own tasks, and it was only three. Imagine for 10 years what you want, three things you want in 10 years, that cannot be hard. Five things or three things in 5 years' time that will take me to there. Then those same three things in 2 years' time that will take me to there. This, you got 2 years to do it. How can this be hard? So if you think this is hard, then one should think about their life. What are they achieving then? If they can't achieve three things in 5 years and 10 years, what are they achieving in their life? You were made to achieve much more than you give yourself credit for. You were not created for working and for business and for marriage and for children. They were not your purpose of creation. Your purpose of creation was something far greater than them. They are just the distractions, but you were not meant to be distracted. So this was not a question really. So inshallah, any questions? Otherwise, inshallah, everyone's understood and has their targets. Go on, the brother, and then we'll finish after this, then, inshallah. Yeah.
So, the best thing is if you've got long-term, like you said, three things for 10 years, so you don't want to overburden yourself.
You can have more. There's nothing wrong with having more, but yes, do not overburden yourself. The burden will be felt not when you look at your 10-year targets. The burden will be felt when you look at your daily targets and your weekly targets. That's when you'll feel the burden. There is a very important saying that if you do not change your daily habits, you cannot change your life. That to change your life, you need to change your daily habits. So this is why everything comes back to the day. Change your day and you will change your life. So, and that's what you see in the course as well. You're stopping sins by the day, not by the week, not by the hour, by the day. So change your day and inshallah you will change your life. Yes, Brother Majid, the last question then. No. So if a person fails their exams then they feel they've not attained their objective, two things to understand. One is, firstly, that they should, this is a principle, you plan, when Allah's plan comes, you replan. You replan. So this is the principle. It was mentioned in the last time I mentioned time management, that you plan. So what you've all done today, you've planned at 5 years, 10 years, and so on. Now, and some of you want to achieve the course finished, and which is very good. But you need to realize that Allah's plan will come, and it will overpower your plan every time. And every time Allah's plan comes, what do? You just replan. And when the person practices this again and again and again, they are actually learning to submit to Allah. That's the meaning of submission, that when Allah's plan comes, I submit and I just replan now. So for example, I give you an example. Today, I didn't think I was doing this speech. So I thought I kind of got away with it. This was my thought, that because yesterday was meant to be, and because of time we couldn't do it, so I thought, okay, today, alhamdulillah. But Allah's plan came and I had to do it. So what did I then do? Not think, oh no, I can't do this speech, I haven't planned and prepared and things. But then I went and brought the resources and prepared them quickly. So it was already there, but it was just to refresh them. So then do you see Allah's plan comes? And then you just go and replan. I had to sacrifice Brother Kess's speech, but listen to it downstairs, and then brought these together and decided what I was going to do. So Allah's plan comes, you replan. Don't complain, just replan. So if a person fails their exam, they also should realize that Allah's plan, if on the condition they tried their best, that's the condition. If they've tried their best and they've failed, then it was Allah's plan for them to fail. And that means that there is goodness in there. I'll give you an example. By them succeeding, they may have become arrogant. And by being arrogant, they might have become people of Jahannam because of this successful degree. How strange, but this happens. People who have very, very high degrees, alims, and then many years of knowledge and all sorts, and then they can never become humble because of their knowledge. Knowledge is one of the seven main reasons people become arrogant. So now look, if the person failed and Allah's plan, look at Allah's plan. They failed, but now they become humble because of it, that I did a degree, but I failed, I don't want to mention it, I'm lowly. They look down on themselves and they attain humbleness through it. And because of this humbleness, they become people of paradise, maybe. So look at the difference. So do you see Allah's plan is always good for the believer, but you have to embrace His plan. And all you have to do is replan. If you want to do, so what would the replan there be? That you want to redo the course, that's fine, redo the course, do mashwara with the people, this is the sunnah and the etiquettes, do mashwara, do istikhara, the prayer, and then decide, do you want to redo it, or do you want to do something else, or do you want to go into work or business, that might be better for you. So these plans are not that they are set in stone, they will change. You replan because Allah's plan will come. But by having plans, you're more likely to reach them. Is that okay? So inshallah there, inshallah we finish and be ready. Inshallah I'll ask people their daily task for the 2-year target when I meet you, inshallah. Jazakallah. Subhanakallah. Wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.